Hello. We now come to a topic, a new topic called dummy variable regression models. Now, what are dummy variables? Often, we find that in our regression analysis, our Y variable is not only influenced by ratio scale variables. By ratio scale variables, I mean things like quantitative variables like income, input, prices, and so on. They are also often affected by certain qualitative variables or variables that can be represented on a nominal scale. Now, what do I mean by qualitative variable? Whether a person is male or female, that is gender, is a qualitative variable. The level of education that you have attained, whether it's up to primary, whether it's middle school, whether it is secondary, higher secondary, or have you got a graduation, or have you got even higher studies, this is a nominal scale variable, right? These levels of education are the variable representing levels of education is a qualitative variable. The geographical region you belong to, the political view that you hold, these are all qualitative variables. So often such qualitative variables can have a strong influence on the dependent variable Y. And if it is a strong influencer, or if it is an important explanatory variable, we should be able to include it in our regression so that we can understand all the important factors or variables that affect our variations in the Y variable. For example, in the labor market, we are always concerned with discrimination. So you might be interested in knowing how is the average wages different for a person who is not male. So is it different for a female? You might want to know if there is a discrimination or a differentiation in your mean wages, hourly or mean weekly wages, based on say the caste of the person. Okay, does a forward caste or a general caste person get paid a higher average wage than say a scheduled caste or a scheduled tribe person? So that would be a study into discrimination. In the US and in the West, we have had a lot of studies which look at racial discrimination. So are the hourly wages that you receive being influenced by the race that you belong to? Does it matter whether you are white or whether you are black or non-Hispanic, non-white? Does it matter that you are of Asian origin? So does that factor influence the hourly wages that a person can get? So these are all examples where one of the determining influencing or explanatory variables is not a qualitative variable. It cannot be measured as income or as output or prices and so on. So to such dependent variables, that is qualitative variables, can be represented by dummy variables. So one way in which we quantify such attributes is by constructing artificial variables which take on values 1 or 0, where 1 indicates presence or possession of that attribute and 0 indicates absence of the attribute. So for example, if I want to represent gender as an explanatory variable, I might say that the dummy variable for gender is 1 if the person is female and 0 if the person is male. If I am looking at levels of education, I might use a dummy variable which takes the value 1 if the person has attained graduation and 0 if the person has not, and so on. So these are artificial variables that take on only 2 values, 1 or 0, or linear forms of those, which indicate presence or absence of a particular qualitative attribute. So the definition, variables that assume 0 or 1 are called dummy variables. They are a device to classify data into mutually exclusive categories, such as say male or female, belonging to the southern region or not, and so on. Now, ANOVA models, or the analysis of variance models, are those models which contain only qualitative variables or dummy variables as the regressors. Remember, regressors mean the X variables or the explanatory variables that appear on the right hand side of the regression function. Now, this example that I have quoted here just to discuss with you, to explain to you, I have taken it directly from the soft copy edition, 5th edition of Damodar Gujarati book that you have already downloaded. As you can see, the example is based, US based, as the book is of the US edition. If you actually purchase the Indian edition, you can see that there are more Indianized and India centered examples. For the time being, I'm going to continue with this example. In this so-called regression model, we are trying to find out whether the average annual salary of public school teachers differs based on the geographical region to which the school belongs to. So, when you examine the data and you take the simple arithmetic average for that is the average salaries of teachers in these three regions differently, you will get three different numbers. That is, for northeast and north central region, you get around $49,538. For the southern region's teachers, you get $46,293. And this is the average salary of the teachers teaching in the western region. Now, in the sample, although these average values are different, remember we are always interested in finding out whether statistically these numbers are different from each other. That is the difference really significant, statistically significant? So we have some sort of hypothesis testing to be done. We are going to discuss the ANOVA model, where we run a regression with the dependent variable being the average annual salary and the independent variables being the dummy variables to represent these combination of geographical regions. So this is what the model would look like if you had to run it. So, like I said, the dependent variable is the average salary of the public school teacher in state I. Beta 1 is the intercept term. We introduce a dummy D2, where D2 is equal to 1. The definitions have been mentioned here. Now, the dummy D2 is equal to 1 if the state is in northeast or north central region. Remember, this is a US based study. Okay, and we have another dummy variable D3, which will be equal to 1 if the state is in the southern region. Okay, and it is 0 if it is not, if it is in any other region. And we have our usual error term. Okay, so assuming that the error term satisfies all the usual assumptions, OLS assumptions, we can figure out that the mean salary of public school teachers in the northeast and north central region. Remember, if the school is situated in the northeast and north central region, the variable D2 will be equal to 1. So here you can see the expected value of YI given D2I is equal to 1, and if it belongs to the northeast and north central region, then it does not belong to the south region, so D3 is equal to 0. So as you can see, based on our question now. Let me just write it here once more. See, our regression model is y is equal to beta 1 plus beta 2 d2i plus beta 3 d3i plus ui. So, as you can see over here, in the first case, you have the expected value of y, given that the public school belongs to the northeast and north central region. So if that is the case, your d2 will take the value 1 and d3 will take the value 0. So putting d2 and equal to 1 and d3 equal to 0 in this equation, in the main regression function, you will get beta 1 plus beta 2 as the expected value or the mean salary of public school teachers in the northeast and north central. Now, how do you find the mean salary of public school teachers in the south? If you belong to the south, your dummy d2i will take the value 0, right? And dummy d3i will take the value 1. So that's what's written here. The expected value of yi given d2i equal to 0 and d3i equal to 1. Now if d2i is equal to 0, as you can see, this term becomes 0. This term becomes beta 3. And of course, when you're talking about the averages, your average of the error term is 0 by over this assumption. So you will get the expected value of yi. Expected value means mean. The mean salary of public school teachers in the south will be beta 1 plus beta 3. And what about mean salary of public school teachers in the third category? Remember, there were three categories. There is also the third category called west. Well, if your public school belongs to the western region, your dummy d2 will be equal to 0, your dummy d3 will also be equal to 0. So the average or the mean salary of public school teachers in the west will be equal to beta 1. Now you have to notice that we have three categories here in terms of geographical regions. Northeast, north central is the first, south and west. So we have three categories. And if we have three categories, we will only include two dummy variables. This is because if we include a third dummy variable such as D4, which is equal to 1 when your school belongs to the western region and equal to 0 otherwise, your three dummies will be linearly related. D2, D3 and D4 will be linearly related. I will explain this once more in more detail later. For the time being, notice that if I have three categories for a particular variable, I will introduce only two dummies. Now, this shows the output. Again, this is from the soft copy edition that you have with you. So this represents, this is the output of the regression that was just run. Here you have the standard errors of the coefficients or the estimators beta 1 hat, beta 2 hat and beta 3 hat. These are the t values and the bracketed terms, numbers here indicate the p values. Remember, the p limit gives you the lowest level of probability at which we can reject the null hypothesis. So as you can see over here, your p value is far lesser than 0.05, which means at 5% level of significance, this value, the intercept 48,014, is very statistically significant. Over here, your p value is 50.52, which means your coefficient of dummy T2 is significant only at 52% level of significance. Okay, and your coefficient of the dummy T3 is also significant only at 0.4888 or 48% level of significance. So obviously we can conclude that these are insignificant or insignificant, or they are not statistically different from 0. Beta 2 and beta 3 are not statistically different from 0. So that's how you would interpret this output term. What about these coefficients? Well, as you can see, the mean salary of the teachers in the West is only beta 1. So it will be 48,000. If I round it up, it will be 48,050. Now, if you belong to the Northeast and North Central region, then your mean salary will be 48,015 plus 1,524. So it will be higher by $1,524. Similarly, if the public school teacher belongs to the southern region, the average salary will tend to be $1,721 lesser than the base category, which is the teacher in the western region. I'm saying it will be lesser because, as you can see, the sign of this coefficient is negative. So since the dummy variables, both the dummy variables have insignificant coefficients, of course, overall conclusion is that the mean salaries of the public school teachers, whether it is the West, the Northeast and North Central, or the South, the mean salaries are more or less the same. The differences, if any, are not statistically significant. Now, the points to note over here. The first thing to remember is when you're interpreting the output of a dummy variable, remember that the coefficients of the dummy variables would only point out the magnitude of the differences. How different is the annual salary in the Northeast and North Central region from the Western region? So while it can give you a quantitative idea of the difference, it will not or cannot suggest any reason for the differences. Why is it that people in the Northeast and North Central region are getting slightly higher payments than salaries than a teacher teaching in the Western region? So those differences will not be given by this regression analysis. For that, you will have to go through the theory and go through the empirical research related to the topic. Now, another point to note is, if a qualitative variable has m categories, you can introduce only m minus 1 dummy variables. If you do not follow this rule, you will fall into what is called the dummy variable trap, that is, the situation of perfect multicollinearity. Now, what do I mean by that? Let me show you over here. Now, remember, we had introduced the one variable T2, which is equal to 1 if you belong to Northeast or North Central region. The dummy D3 was if you belonged to the South. And now, suppose you have a dummy D4 which represents any public school belonging to the Western region. Now, so if I have, if the school belongs to Northeast, North Central, this will be how the dummy's values look. If the school belongs to the Southern region, D3 will be 1, while D2 and D4 will be 0. And if your school belongs to the Western region, D4 will be 1, while D2 and D3 will be 0. So these are the three possibilities for any public school will belong to either one of these regions. Now, if you see D2 plus D3 plus D4, that is a simple additive linear relationship, all of it adds up to 1, right? So what you are seeing is that your explanatory variables D2, D3 and D4 are perfectly multicollinear or perfectly linearly related, because the sum of these three values is equal to 1. This is the relation between the three variables D2 plus D3 plus D4 is equal to 1. And that gives you the problem of perfect linear collinearity or multicollinearity. Right? And this is called the dummy variable trap. We want to avoid this. That's why if you have m categories, you will introduce, for a qualitative variable, you will introduce m minus 1 variables. And whichever category you do not introduce the dummy for is called your base category. So in this example, we did not introduce a dummy for the Western region. So the Western region is called the base category of the dummy variable. I hope this is clear. Okay. Now, the category for which no dummy is assigned is known as the base, benchmark, control, comparison, reference, or omitted category, all synonymous words for. Okay. Any of these words, it can be called the base category, the benchmark category, the omitted category, the reference category. So all these terms can be used interchangeably. So remember, when we are interpreting the coefficients of the other dummies, we are interpreting them as a comparison made in relation to the benchmark category. So in a regression such as the above one, where you have only dummy variables as your regressors or your explanatory variables, the intercept beta 1 will represent the mean value of the benchmark category. So if you notice over here, the Western region is taken as the benchmark category, and as you can see, the expected value of yi and d2i and d3i is equal to 0 is equal to beta 1. So the intercept term gives you the mean value of the dependent variable of the benchmark category or the base category. Note that the coefficients attached to the dummy variables are known as differential intercept coefficients, because they are telling you by how much value of the category that receives for which the dummy is 1 will differ from the intercept coefficient of the benchmark category. So again, you have a look at this, your benchmark category, the mean value or the mean salary is beta 1, and if your school belongs to the south, that is D3 is equal to 1, the difference in the intercept will be beta 1 plus beta 3. So it will tell you, the beta 3 will tell you the difference in the mean salary between the base category, which is the west, and the southern region. Similarly, beta 2 is the coefficient of the northeast to north central dummy. So this beta 2 tells you by how much is the mean salary of the northeast and north central school different from the base category, which is the western region. So beta 1 plus beta 2. Hence the term differential intercept coefficients. Now, the choice of the benchmark category is left to the researcher. For many qualitative variables, there are often conventions that have been set up. However, the researcher has full freedom to decide which is the benchmark category. Okay, so you might choose to run the earlier example regression with maybe the northeast and north central region as the base category, and your two dummies that are there are dummies belonging to the southern region and belonging to the western region. You have the freedom, you have the choice. Okay. Now, there is a way to circumvent or to escape the dummy variable trap, even if we introduce as many dummy variables as the number of categories in that variable. That is, if you have m categories, you can still introduce m dummies and escape the dummy variable trap if you decide to run the regression without an intercept. So remember, you should run the regression without an intercept if you decide to introduce m dummies or m categories of the qualitative variable. Here is another example, again from the same soft copy book that you have with you. Here we have, it is still an ANOVA model because we only have dummy variables as our regressors or explanatory variables, but we have two qualitative variables. I'm sorry, this should be two qualitative variables, not qualitative models. Okay. So, what are the two qualitative categories that we are taking? Well, we are looking at how hourly wages that are received. Why is the hourly wages? We are looking at how hourly wages are received are influenced by the fact that you are married or single, and how is it affected by the region where you reside. So here we have two variables. So the dummy will represent two different. D2 will be equal to 1 if the person is married, and 0 if the person is not. D3 is a dummy to indicate the qualitative variable region of residence. It is equal to 1 if the residence, if you reside in the south, and equal to 0 otherwise. Over here also you can see, so your base category now, which is the mean hourly wage of the base category, is again given by the intercept term, which is 8.8148. But you have to understand what the base category is. The base category here will be an unmarried person who does not reside in the south, who resides in any portion other than the southern region of the country. Right, this is because the base category for the marital status is unmarried, and the base category for the region of residence variable is where you do not belong to south. So the intercept in this model will represent the average hourly salary of $8.81 or $8.82 if you are unmarried and not belonging to the southern part of the state. Now, ANOVA models or models with only qualitative variables are generally found more in the field of sociology and politics and anthropology and similar subjects. When you come to economics, we most often have a mixture of quantitative and qualitative analysis. And when you have both qualitative and quantitative variables in your regression model, we call them the analysis of covariance models or ANCOVA models. So ANCOVA models is an extension of ANOVA, where they provide a method for controlling the effects of the quantitative regressors. The quantitative regressors that appear in the ANCOVA models or in the regression model where we have both types of variables, the quantitative variables are called the covariates or control variables. Again, let's understand this by looking at the example. We are continuing with the same example where we are trying to determine the average annual salary of public school teachers in the state. Okay. Like earlier, we have beta 1 plus beta 2 D2I, where D2I is a dummy which is equal to 1 if the school belongs to the northeast or north central region. D3 is equal to 1 if the school belongs to the southern region, 0 otherwise. And here is our quantitative variable, which is expenditure on public schools by the local authority. So we're calling it public education, right? So even in the US, public education is primarily, even though it's a government subject, it is primarily a local and state question. So the local authorities have a large say in decisions related to spending on public education. So being an important variable, it is a quantitative variable that appears as an explanatory variable of the average annual salary of the public school teachers. So like I said, the quantitative variable that appears is known as the covariate in the ANCOVA model. And here is the regression results or the output of the regression that was run. So the intercept term is significant at 5% here. Okay, look at this. Single star indicates that the p-value is less than 5%, and double star indicates that p-values are greater than 5%. So you will need to look at, as you can see, the intercept term is statistically significant at 5% level of significance, and so is our quantitative covariate, that is public expenditure on education by the local governments, is also a statistically significant variable at 5% level of significance. These two dummies, the coefficients of the dummy variable, continue to remain insignificant at 5% level of alpha. coefficient of the variable public spending or public expenditure on education is positive 2.34, which can be interpreted as if you increase expenditure on public expenditure on education by $1 on an average, the public school teacher's salary, that is the Y variable, will increase by around $2.34. Right? So remember, that is how we interpret the coefficients of the covariates of the quantitative variables. So the interpretation does not change in any sense. It is the same as what we have discussed in other multivariable